Yes, I was a senator, but I was also a mother. I had to see about children. I had to see about children more than Parliament sometimes. So when I went to Parliament, I told them what I thought about this bill or that bill. Then I would leave and come away home. I had to look after the children and the house. You know what I mean?
Excerpts from the Capaldeo speeches, 1957 to 1994. Last recorded interview with Kalawatee Permanand, April 2nd, 1994. Kalawatee Capaldeo Permanand was born into a dynasty. She represented three of the most powerful East Indian families in Trinidad, namely the Capaldeos, the Permanands, and the Naipauls. Originally a Capaldeo, she became a Permanand through an arranged marriage at the age of 12. Her nephews include world-renowned author Sir Vidya S. Naipaul and sibling author Shiva Naipaul. But it is her association with her brother, former opposition leader Rudranath Capaldeo, that placed Kalawatee in the midst of politics and led to her serving as an opposition senator in the late 1960s. Politics in her blood. Kalawatee Capaldeo Permanand. Opposition DLP senator, 1966 to 1971.
Now, in the period you became a senator, in the 1960s, a lot of women would not have been involved in politics. What or who encouraged you into politics? Was it your brother or your brothers?
Nobody encouraged me. Not my brothers. I encouraged myself. I said, I am going, that's all. My brothers were happy that I was together with them. They used to tell me, what is the difference between brothers and sisters when we have one mother and one father? We live together. I held a view, and my brothers respected it, that if men could get into politics, so could women. If men could do it, women could do it. If women could not go into politics, their children would not be able to learn about it. The children would be at a loss. If you do not teach your children about politics, how would they know?
While she was in the Senate, I don't think she did anything political or made any political speeches or handled anything in the politics. I don't think she was a member of the party, an active member of the party. I don't think she organized any branches or did anything. But on the other hand, she lived at 65 Carlos Street, which was dead center. So her house became the center of the PDP, DLP, whatever the party was at that point in time. That was the assembly point. And as fate would have it, is directly opposite the rum shop that still exists.
Her contribution in the Senate, I would say, was minimal, because at that time when she made a senator, the opposition had taken a position that they would take no part in any debate which is held in Parliament. And this was a direct order by Dr. Rudranath Capaldeo. That the reason, I think, for that order, at that time they were trying to get rid of the voting machine and replace it with the ballot box. And that was the reason for that stand, take no part in any debate. I think that was the reason. There may be other reasons, but that is the one that stands out in my mind. And so I suppose in that sense, she was part of that movement. And I must tell you, she was a very vociferous woman. What she had to say, she said it loud and clear. She had no respect. She never minced her words. She wanted to tell you something, she just tells it to you. You like it or lump it. It was entirely up to you.
Kalawatee, who came from a family, our extended family, we're looking at about nine brothers and three sisters, including herself. One of the brothers died in childbirth. She had had duties to perform at home. So for her to be engaged in public life and also develop that skill of debating would have been really asking a lot of her. Compared to her brothers who were in public life for so many years and who were professionally trained. But what I could say is that while she may not compare to the extent with her brothers, her younger siblings, what we found is that there were glimpses of her ability to argue and debate. at the Senate level during the period when she was a senator between 1966 and 1971. And I'm sure that if she hadn't had to alternate between family life and public life, she would have made a very good debater and parliamentarian.
Kalawatee Permanand has the distinction of being born in Kapildeo House in 1906, which was immortalized in the V.S. Naipaul's novel, A House for Mr. Biswas, as the Lion House. When she married Pundit Ramnarese Permanand in 1918, they lived there at first before moving to Claxton Bay as part of the Permanand family. Later, with her husband, she rejoined the wider Kapildeo family, who have moved from Chagornis to their estate in Pitti Valley. From there, the extended unit relocated to St. James and Woodbrook to allow their children to be closer to school. Kalawatee and Pundit Ramnarese had four children: Rabindranath, a former High Commissioner to the United Kingdom; Bidwati, Chitrawati, and Sawati.
My grandmother had several girl children and two boy children. And one among the girl children was Bhula Mosi, was Draupadi Naipaul. Draupadi Naipaul's daughter, Kamla, was the first girl of the Kapildeo clan to get a scholarship through my father, Simunath, via the Indian High Commission to go to Banaras University to study in Banaras to get a BA. When she did that, V.S. Naipaul was on his way up to winning a scholarship, but he was in St. Mary's, and he decided he couldn't make it from St. Mary's, and he came to QRC. He won the scholarship from QRC and went to Oxford. And thereafter began the legend of V.S. Naipaul.
What is certain is that Naipaul spent a tremendous amount of time with a large extended family of his maternal grandmother's family circle, the Kapildeos, which he disliked tremendously and often reiterated. There was always constant noise and it was always overcrowded. Excerpt from V.S. Naipaul's Empty Chapel by Dr. John Prasad Ramphal. Of the entire dynasty that emerged from the lineage of Pundit Kapildeo and his indomitable wife Suji Gobind Kapildeo, the Kapildeos became identified with politics, the Permanands with law, and the Naipauls with creative writing, resulting in world-famous novels. While two Kapildeo sisters married two Permanand sons, Sister Draupadi married Sipasad Naipaul, establishing that part of the family tree. Another sister, Bidmati, married Satnarayan Pandey, further extending a powerful heritage. Among the politicians in the ancestry, Dr. Rudranath Kapildeo, Kalawatee's youngest brother, is perhaps the most acclaimed. Not only was he an international physicist and mathematician, but as leader of the opposition, he would have been instrumental with Dr. Eric Williams in negotiating independence from Britain for Trinidad and Tobago.
In the early days, in the early 50s, I'd say from 56 onwards, when Dr. Williams came and laid his bucket down, as he said, doctor politics became the in thing. And so the Negro community, the African community, had Dr. Williams, and the Indian community, Indian stroke Hindu community, had to look for their doctor too. And they found Dr. Kapildeo. So you had the amalgamation of Dr. Kapildeo and Dr. Williams. And they were bitter political enemies. So bitter that at one stage, I don't know if you do your research, you'll see the 1961 meeting in the Savannah. This country could have been split in two if Dr. Kapildeo had had his way, when he said, arm yourselves. But he went to the conference in Marlborough House, and there's where the true statesmanship of both Williams and Kapildeo came to the fore. And they decided, forget the hostility and the bitterness of the local politics, and let us give Trinidad an independent constitution.
The impact that they made on it is, as far as my Rudranath is concerned, well, you know, he was a mathematician, Highland Scholar winner. He had a chair at London University. Naipaul, of course, Vidya, Sir Vidya. He was a very bright boy, won Highland Scholarship too, just like Rudranath Kapildeo. And he went on to be a world-famous author. So his impact on Trinidad must be one of some pride to all the whole family. And I hope our nation will still respect them for what they have contributed.
When Dr. Rudranath Kapildeo returned from England in 1961, there was a big welcome ceremony at the Piako Airport. There's a photograph of him with a garland of flowers around his neck and you next to him?
Yes, it was me who garlanded him. The DLP was happy to have him return, but I, as his older sister, was even more happy. He used to stay at my home whenever he came from abroad. Not long after, all the sisters went to India on a tour in 1962. We also visited all our relatives there. I like India. The people obey each other there. They respect you.
Dr. Kapalio was against the voting machines used in the 1961 general election. He preferred the ballot box.
He was against the voting machines and he told them that straight. Straight. He told the PNM the voting machines could be rigged. I agreed with him. But the PNM still used the voting machines. You see, they wanted to win the elections.
Always close to Rudranath, it was no surprise when Kalawatee was selected in 1966 to be an opposition senator by her brother, who was leader of the opposition. However, a year later, her role in Parliament became even more critical for Rudranath since he lost his Shigona seat after it was declared vacant due to his continuous absences. With Vernon Jabidar capturing leadership from the party in 1969, Kalawatee maintained the Kapaldeo name in Parliament.
There were two sisters of Dr. Rudranath and Sibonath Kapaldeo who used to advise them. You were one of them. Who was the other?
That was Danpat. She was older than me. We used to be together all the time. When I was a senator, she accompanied me to Parliament. We went to meetings together. We had to tell Rudranath what was happening here whenever he came from England. He also respected and listened to our advice. We trusted each other.
She was the eyes and ears of Dr. Rudranath Kapaldeo while he was based in London and dabbling in Trinidad politics. She kept him informed of what was going on in Trinidad politics. And nobody would admit it, no member of his family. I'd probably get into problems with the family for saying her reward was a seat in the Senate. And she got a seat in the Senate. And I don't know if you look up an answer and find out if she said anything while she was in the Senate. But that was an adequate report for her reporting to Dr. Kapaldeo all the things that went on in politics and in the Kapaldeo estate.
Did you give him any advice? Sibonath, that is. I know you advised both brothers later on in politics, you yourself becoming a senator.
I had to ring Sibonath's ear very often. When he was talking nonsense, even as a child, I used to ring his ears. You see, he was my younger brother and had to listen to me. When he became involved in politics, he used to come by me in the night and would ask me, "What you think of so-and-so?" I never hesitated to tell him. I would speak my mind. But I used to make him write it down, his query, if I could not give him an opinion right away. The next night, he would come again and I would tell him what I thought. So we used to communicate all right, and very often.
Although there is no record of Kalawatee Kapaldeo having spoken in Parliament, she was a member of the House Committee and served a full term of 5 years in the Senate. Her nephew, Surindradath Kapaldeo, was also a senator, continuing the family tradition.
I know your nephew, Surindradath Kapaldeo, visits you often. He is a senator like you were. What do you think of Surin?
Well, it is a good thing he got into politics. His father Sibonath would not wish it otherwise. He has my blessings and I think he would make a good contribution to the country. But most of that is left to seen. I do not know whether I would still be here.
I'm sure you would. I see no reason why you should not live to be 100 years. Right now you're 87 and your niece Pula is here to care for you.
Well, if God is willing, I leave that in the hands of God. Jai Sitarama.
She had that, that kind of strength and outspokenness that would be an example for so many of our women today. I think in one of the books that V.S. Naipaul's authorized autobiography, The World is What It Is, the author Peter French was referring to Naipaul's mother, Drupati, who would be Kalawatee's sister, as being such an outspoken and confident individual. That sort of confidence that Kalawatee exuded would be something that a lot of our young people could learn from, because so many people lack that self-confidence. And something that virtue or value, if it could be nurtured in today's generation, I think we'll be a better off society.
She was a great advocate of equality, of gender equality. Women's rights was her pet. And I remember she asking one day, why do boys get 4 scholarships and girls only get 1 open scholarship? I can go on much more than that, but that is, I think, makes the point of what she thought about what should happen between equality of gender. They should always have the same opportunity. You mustn't discriminate because of gender. A woman has as much right as a man in anything that affects the country. It must not be a man's world. It must be a joint thing. And that was her fetish, if you want to call it that. That was something she felt very strongly about. And I think which she argued all along, especially when they were on the campaign trail.
When I look at it, it's amazing, because I mean, if you knew Kalawatee, she was, Naipaul described them as 4 feet wide, 4 feet tall, and 4 feet deep. I think you could extend her position. Not me, I didn't describe them. That was V.S. Naipaul describing his aunt. 4 feet wide, 4 feet tall, and 4 feet deep. She fit that dotty. They were all fat, chubby people. But my memory of them is they were all extremely bright people. And if my grandmother had the financial wherewithal, they would all have been professional people. They would all have been doctors and lawyers. They were bright. And they passed that on to their children.
Today, with a favorable percentage of female parliamentarians present in both houses of parliament, the contribution made by pioneers such as Kalawatee Kapildeo Permanand is marked for the voice that was silent but strong.